fighting out of the red corner, 31 years of age, at a height of 5'9", 155 pounds, from Jacksonville, Florida. Fighting out of Obake Dojo with a record of 0-0, debut fight, red corner, Jamal McLennan. And his opponent in this mixed martial arts amateur bout, scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds, in the blue corner at 20 years of age, at a height of 5'11", 155 pounds, from Statesville, North Carolina, fighting out of champion Muay Thai, blue corner, James Campbell. Once again, I want to welcome everybody to Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, and welcome to round one, brought to you by Hooters.
I'd like to welcome everybody to Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment and Hooters.
I'm Kyle Maynard, and I'm sitting here with Cliff Fretwell. We're getting ready to go. Got the stare down.
First amateur bout of the night.
Somebody will be a winner, somebody's a loser.
Campbell.
Welcome to Fight Night 13.
Looking at the teletape, Kyle, right off the bat, looks like age might be a factor. McLennan, 31 years old. Campbell, 20.
You know, McLennan, though, it looks like we got a little bit of a role reversal here, because McLennan's not looking like the older guy in this fight.
Not your typical 31-year-old.
This guy is more shredded than I've ever been in my life.
Yep.
Or could ever hope to be. He's fighting out of Team Obake down in Jacksonville, Florida. These guys came up, made the trip. He looks focused. Already throwing some combos. Heavy body shot.
McLennan's bringing it early. Campbell's trying to shut him down with a plum clinch. McLennan's staying busy, though. Got him up against the rope. He's throwing some haymakers. Nice combinations.
He's got him cornered up against the fence here. He's just got to stay out of that tie clinch.
Campbell needs to weather the storm and regroup right here. He's in a little bit of trouble. He's going to be getting a standing eight count here in shortly if he doesn't start defending himself a little bit better.
Yep. He's just eating these shots now.
Andy Foster's watching him close, our referee in the ring tonight. He's trying to tie him up, but McLennan is just being way too busy. Nice sweep. Looks like McLennan's going to want to keep this on his feet at this point.
McLennan's content with that. Campbell, I think, was confident that the stand-up training at Champion Fitness, that they're known for their Muay Thai, and I don't know. McLennan's just taking it to him. He's definitely winning the stand-up battle here. Short
Campbell
of
lands
knees.
A couple nice knees there, though.
Campbell's trying hard from that clinch. It's hard to be able to control the head like that. I mean, in any combat sport, you get control of the head, you're able to move the body. If you look at this back, though, and his ribs, he is eating some heavy shots.
Yeah, he's redded up already. He's got some whelps on his back. He's got some whelps on his head. McLennan just bringing it early.
You know, you got to wonder, though, if McLennan's going to be able to keep this pace for too long.
Campbell's taking a little bit of abuse here in the first round, but he's firing back. Nice straight jab down the middle. But McLennan walks right through it.
It's good to see an exciting amateur fight like this. We were discussing the rules a little bit beforehand with the changes. I mean, going to the ground is not quite what it used to be.
Yeah, there has been some changes in the Georgia amateur rules for people who are not aware of that. There has been a lot of changes. No strikes to the head on the ground. It's more of a grappling match on the ground now. But they just got a little bit thicker gloves and shin pads. Everything on their feet is pretty much the same. But McLennan's slowing down a little bit here. Campbell's stood in there like a champ. McLennan with another takedown, though.
McLennan, you see him hanging with his tongue out, all that. I mean, he's definitely got the physique, but you got to wonder if he came out and just gassed himself out, throwing those early.
Yeah.
If Campbell's smart here, you know, he knows that he really can't get this round back.
Hands are down. Campbell just needs to protect himself.
Oh! It was a slip there.
That was a slip and a fall. Looked like Campbell slipped and McLennan fell into him. Side control here. He can only throw punches to the body here and submit. Can't punch to the head, no elbows.
Campbell's trying to scoot that knee in and retain, get back to half guard or full guard here. He's trying to block that mount first. See if he get it back.
Campbell's got his knee through there, but McLennan's just going to stand up. Can't hit to the head right here. Can only hit to the body. Andy Foster's keeping a close eye on him there.
Campbell's had to eat some vicious body shots, and that's...
Campbell coming up in a low single there. Couldn't finish it. That's going to be the end of round one.
Round, you gotta go with McLennan on that, but I wonder if his gas tank's going to be able to see him through the next two.
We were talking when the intros came in, and we were talking about McLennan's physique. We were talking about Campbell looking like the smaller man, but I'll tell you what now. Campbell looks like this fight actually could be something he could come back and win. McLennan, I think, might have actually used a little bit too much energy in that first round.
I think he definitely could have. We're going to have to see what happens in this next round. We got, you know, pretty solid instruction. Rick Davis, head instructor over at Champion Muay Thai and Fitness in Statesville, North Carolina. You know he's going to be giving some good advice over to his guy here, James Campbell.
They got some good guys out of that gym. Chris Klodfelter fighting on our card later tonight, fights out of that gym. He's been a regular Wild Bills Fight Night veteran. So they got good fighters coming out of the gym. They're well-trained. If I'm in Campbell's corner, I'm telling him just stay good position, hands up. Let's see how much McLennan's got in this next round. Campbell can weather the storm and come back and maybe point this out or even maybe get a knockout.
He does. He can keep his hands up and control that clinch like he did before. Push the pace. You know, I think he really, you know, going through and surviving that first round, you know, may have been able to, he's got a chance to win this fight now.
31 is definitely not 20 years old. We'll see what kind of energy McLennan has in his second round. He looks
He's coming out strong again, though.
He's making me eat my words right off the bat. Nice Superman punch right in the middle. He's going to town on the body. Oh,
eating those uppercuts
hard. Campbell. Well, Campbell's a little wobbly here.
The new rule is the standing eight count in MMA for amateur rules. So that's actually one of the first times I've seen it used.
Yeah, and actually a lot of people are opposed to the eight count because it actually lets a guy that's hurt stay in there and take more abuse, some people want to argue.
Oh, another Superman punch.
I think Andy Foster might be stopping this one. Surely, he's going to the body pretty heavy.
Campbell's finding a home for those uppercuts now. Campbell's right hand is just letting loose.
Yeah, that's it. Andy Foster waves it off. I tell you, Campbell's got hard, but McLennan just had too much leather tonight, too much leather.
McLennan was able to get it back after that round and get some gas to get going. Crowd's not pleased with that stoppage.
Yeah, well, the crowd's got to understand, though, these guys are amateurs. Andy Foster trying to preserve their health and their safety so they can fight again.
Yeah, that,
you don't want you don't want an amateur ending his career and his amateur debut. So Foster did the right thing.
That's by far and away the most important decision is, you know, to for the fighter's safety first and foremost. That's going to preserve our sport, you know, and what we love and allow us to enjoy it for many years to come. You know, you can't have people getting injured and then, you know, it takes every bit of enjoyment away from it.
McLennan definitely brought his A game tonight. Campbell's not far off. I say he goes back to the gym, trains a little bit more stand-up, trains a little bit more defense. He kept the plumb. He had the plumb clinch early. He's definitely working good technique out there. I just think McLennan was just throwing too much too often, and Campbell just couldn't weather the storm and come back.
You know, I'm excited to see these Ibaki guys for the rest of the night. It'll be fun. It'll definitely be a great fight card.
In our first fight of the night, amateur mixed martial arts debut fights for both fighters. In the second round at the 50-second mark, stoppage by the referee, and your winner, red corner, Jamal McLennan out of Jacksonville, Florida.
Jacksonville, Florida taking home a win tonight.
Your winner, with a record of 1-0, Jamal McLennan, red corner. Let's give a round of applause here for James Campbell, blue corner.
Good fight, good start to the night.
All right, in the red corner, at 27 years of age, 5'10", 188 pounds, from Jacksonville, Florida, fights out of the Obeck Dojo. Debut bout, Eric Skates. His opponent in the blue corner, 26 years of age, at a height of 5'8", 190 pounds, from McDonough, Georgia. Fights out of Hard Knocks MMA with a record of 1-0. Let's hear it for Chris Ruiz. Your referee will be Mr. John Sosby. Welcome to round one of your second fight of the night in Wild Bills Fight Night.
I'd like to welcome everybody here to Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment and Hooters.
We're getting ready to go, touching gloves. It's going to be a pretty evenly matched fight, I think. These guys coming in, both of them are pretty fresh amateurs. Chris Ruiz is 1-0 already.
Ruiz going for the takedown early, got a body lock. A little over-under position here.
Pummeling from this clinch here. Trying to get an advantage. Oh, a little lateral that ends up getting him caught in cross-eyed.
Looks like Skates might have meds him there a little bit. Traditional wrestling move.
Skates going for the pass here, trying to stuff that leg down and come around to the opposite side.
Amateur rules changed a little bit in Georgia. You can only hit to the body in this position or submit. You can't strike to the head if you're wondering why he's not hitting him in the head.
Chris has got those legs open. I'm not sure why he didn't take that opportunity to pass his other leg around and get in the dominant position, which is that cross side right there. Or Eric, rather. Eric's on top here. Eric Skates, fighter out of Jacksonville, Florida, in the Obaki Dojo. Tough guys. They got Charlie Blanchard down there as an instructor. We got one of the other guys fighting tonight, Tony Souza. Looking forward to seeing him compete. Got some pretty solid guys. And the head instructor down there, Tim Catalfo, Pride veteran. These guys have got good instruction.
Yeah, Catalfo's been around for a while. Anybody that's been around MMA in Georgia for a while knows Tim Catalfo. Had an Obaki gym around here in Georgia a while back. Was a big figure on the MMA scene when it first started getting popular way back in mid-90s. Ruiz is trying to secure a guillotine here. It's going to be kind of hard with these bigger gloves. These gloves look like MMA gloves, but they kind of feel like 14-ounce gloves when you get hit with them. They got extra padding. A little bit more of a grappling match we got going on here. I don't understand why Skates hadn't completely passed into side control yet, though.
It is, yeah. He's got the open opportunity right here. Every time that Ruiz on bottom opens his legs up there from that half guard, Eric's able to move around on top, and he should be able to pass into a dominant position, and really that's what the judges are looking for. He's winning here this round just by being on top, but nobody's done any damage. If they get stood back up, then one exchange could decide this round.
Ruiz is to his feet. If he would just flare out of this double right here, he could just drop down to a double leg and score, but now he's got to defend the guillotine. Skates hits a knee there. Ruiz just should drop to a double leg and just flare out here and score.
Ruiz is trying to jack up that single. And he's able to get it. This round's going back and forth. That doesn't look like too much of a guillotine in there. He's able to get his head out.
Ruiz needs to cut that knee up the middle, secure side control, and start looking for a submission or trying to hit, get some body shots in there and score some damage for the end of the round.
We got that 10-second mark. Just clap. There we go. Taking it back. You know what?
Rush the choke.
That scrambled. I don't know. Who would you say get that round to? Eric spent most of it on top, but
I think Ruiz might have stole that round from him. He rushed that rear naked choke a little bit. Almost ended up in a schoolyard choke there at the end. We got a pretty even match on our hands. Skates, in his pre-fight interview, just said he was just going to come out here, knock him out, and go back to Florida. And Ruiz actually has something to say about it.
To get going again. We'll see if these guys can get a little bit more action going from the feet.
Round two, Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment, Hooters, Atlanta Classic Cars.
Wow.
Ruiz firing down the middle. I don't know why he went for the takedown. He was throwing some solid shots down the middle, caught Skates off guard, and then came in for a double leg, ended up body lock.
Skates was sleeping on that, but came back, and it looked like he was able to land a few flush hooks. Swinging in those kind of wild haymaker fashion, but
190 pounds, over under Wizard. These guys look like they've had some wrestling experience. They're out there hitting some traditional wrestling moves out there. It's a battle of the base, and Skate wins again.
Yeah, Skate's able to come on top. He's able to stay on top most of the first round, but he really hasn't done too much. The pass here is wide open again. He's able to, would be able to open that up, that foot up, and secure a more dominant position. A lot of guys, though, the problem is they'll just feel more comfortable on top in the half guard.
Right, right.
You know, it's really, it's not even a more stable position. I personally, when I'm on bottom, like to play from half guard.
Oh, we got Mount here. No.
Going back to
Ruiz
full.
Ruiz is doing a good job of keeping that knee cut up the middle. They're in a scramble here in the ropes. Looks like Ruiz is going to score a change in position here, or improvement in position, rather. Ruiz needs to get behind him. Watch the Kimura here. Skate thought about a Kimura just for a second. Now he's worried about protecting his neck.
Almost able to secure this rear naked choke in. He's got the right arm weaved underneath Skates' throat. If he's able to get one hook in here, this could be bad news for Skates. He chokes in. Choke secured.
It's deep.
That's deep.
He's got it in deep.
There's no hooks, but there's a tap.
Skates is tapping. That's it. It's all over. Reeves weathers an early takedown. Scrambles out.
Displayed real solid grappling skills, taking them back there from multiple situations. Just didn't have enough time to do anything with it in the first round. Showed good work from the clinch, and then when it's got to the ground, then both guys seemed pretty evenly matched. Ruiz this time, though, was able to take that back, and even without having any hooks in, he's able to secure that choke and get the victory.
Yeah, we were talking earlier about it looks like both these guys had a wrestling background. A lot of times you'll find that wrestlers are safe in that guard, and they tend to relax there a little bit. Ruiz got a knee up the middle, looked for a sweep, got in a scramble, and ended up with a rear naked choke in the fight.
Exactly. You want to secure the dominant position when you can. You should never give up an opportunity, and I'm sure Skates is regretting that right now.
All right, our second fight of the night. Mixed martial arts, amateur bout, scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds. Your winner in the second round at 1:38 with a rear neck and choke, red corner, Chris Blue Corner, Chris Ruiz is your winner. I apologize. Your winner, Blue Corner, 1:38, second round, a rare neck and check hold.
Dude's got some cauliflower to it, I didn't see that.
Fighting out of McDonough, Georgia, Hot Knocks Gym MMA, Chris Ruiz, Blue Corner, with a record now of 2 wins, no losses. Eric Skates with his debut bout. 0 wins, 1 loss. Introducing in the red corner, 25 years of age, 5'10", 165 pounds, fighting out of Carrollton, Georgia, for top of the line fitness with a record of 2-2. Red corner, Daryl Brody. His opponent, fighting out of the blue corner, 24 years of age, at a height of 5'11", 165 pounds, from McDonough, Georgia, fighting for Hard Knocks MMA with a record of 2 wins, no losses, Blue Corner, Brian Moore. Your referee will be Andy Foster. This is an amateur mixed martial arts bout scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds. Welcome to round 1 and brought to you by Hooters.
I'd like to welcome everybody to Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment, Hooters, Atlanta Classic Cars. Getting the last instructions here. 165 pounds, Perotti, Moore.
I'm excited about this fight. This has the makings to be a tremendous fight. I've trained with Perotti. He's a super nice guy, tough Marine. Moore looks to be an athletic guy. I think this is one of his first, if not his first, amateur fight.
Little right hook there into a double leg. Perotti defending off well.
Trying that foot sweep there. Right into a guillotine. No, he's out of it now.
These gloves are really going to be hard to get a guillotine with these gloves. They look like MMA gloves. They feel more like 14-ounce, 12-ounce gloves. Really hard to secure any type of rear naked choke or guillotine or anything like that if a guy's defending it properly.
Does make it a little bit more difficult. You're definitely right about that. I think Perotti's won his last fight, I believe, at Wild Bill's via triangle choke. So
setting up for an armbar, it looked like there.
He's definitely comfortable off of his back. He's got solid jiu-jitsu skills. Moore does as well. I mean, he's training under Byron Stone, head instructor over at Hard Knocks MMA. He's a 7-1 pro fighter himself and a black belt under Roberto Travin, who's world champion. So
yeah, he actually came up through the ranks with Jacare's Alliance School here in Atlanta. So Byron Stone definitely knows what it takes to get these guys ready. He's going to be well-schooled in jiu-jitsu. He's going to be well-schooled on the ground for sure.
Brian Moore's trying to build up, posture up, and work on his base a little bit more. Makes it hard to rain down any shots when you got a really active guard like Perotti's working here.
Yeah, he's walking up a high guard there. Looks like he was looking for a sweep there.
He's climbing it up.
Moore is actually looking for a pass. They might get reset here. Andy Foster's going to let him go as long as he can until the ropes are just kind of impeding all action at all.
Able to circle around. Perotti's still working from this half guard position. He's showing really good jiu-jitsu technique so far.
Looked for a Kimura there just for half a second.
Perotti's looking for a sweep right here. He's going underneath that leg, trying to swim underneath and trying to pull him up over top.
Yeah, Perotti needs to get a left underhook there. He needs to get an underhook with his left arm, skate his hips away, and then look for the sweep. Kimura.
Defended the Kimura well, was able to get out of that. It's hard to secure it on a guy in this first round before, you know, fatigue comes a factor.
Yeah.
He's playing a weird little reversal game right here. Perotti trying to catch that single leg. Yeah,
Perotti needs a base up right here. Get some hand control and just kind of back out. He's going to pull that leg in.
He's almost got his back taken here, though. Moore, if he's smart, is able to secure a hook right here and take his back. It's going to be a dangerous position for Perotti. That choke's already sunk in.
He's got a side choke there. He's kind of falling off the side.
Wow, this is exciting grappling action we're seeing here. Perotti's back in the guard of Moore, working on top. He's going to want to try to open him up and pass. You can't really just be content with staying and laying body shots. Really not, it's not going to do you too much. You got to work for that submission coming off the side.
It's going to make you look busy, but in the grand scheme of things, as far as damage is concerned, you're not going to get a lot of damage with those gloves on the body.
Now, every one of the judges here, I mean, they're experienced. They know enough that, I mean, it's, you know, those shots really aren't scoring too much. That was a really even round for those two solid submission attempts with that Kimura and the almost rear naked choke. I'd say I'd have to get that round to Moore.
Yeah, you got two different philosophies of that. You got judges who like an active guard or like a guy that's actively looking for a submission, and you also got judges that think just because you went for a submission and missed it, you shouldn't necessarily get credit.
Right. What's your take on that? I'd be interested to know.
My take on that, honestly, is that if you go for a submission, if you're looking to end the fight, I think is what the judges should look for. If you're looking to end the fight and actively looking to end the fight and not just going for submissions to improve your position, there's a difference between going for a submission to improve your position or going for a submission to look for a sweep and kind of half-heartedly going for a submission as opposed to really trying to end the fight. And experienced judges know that. They've seen enough fights. They've seen enough grappling to know whether you're really trying to end the fight with a submission or you're just trying to create a scramble or you know, change the position.
Exactly,
there.
Yeah, sometimes it's going to loosen you up a little bit. They're going back to that ground game right away.
Morin's right back up on his back.
It's hard work from these positions. If you saw Perotti in between that round, the guy's in phenomenal shape, tough Marine, you know, he's gone through just about, you know, any excruciating training you can imagine, and he was pretty gassed after that, and they spent the whole round just scrambling there from the ground. Jiu-jitsu's tough work. You know, people think that the stand-up games, you know, if you're able to control that, it's kind of the misnomer that with boxing being so popular that, you know, the more people learn about jiu-jitsu, you know, it's really, you know, taking the world by storm. Brody's almost got this mount here.
He's cutting that knee up. He's cutting that knee up the middle. He gets it free and gets mount position. He could actually set up an arm bar and end this fight.
Good job by Moore. Moore timed that really well to be able to sweep him up that and kind of come around and reverse out of that mount. You know, as soon as that guy's looking to pass and get on top of you, that's exactly when you want to use that energy to explode up.
Correct.
And get back in his guard.
And mount's not the dominant position was earlier in MMA history. You know, a lot of times you just go out there and just immediately go for the mount. It's not near the dominant position because guys are learning how to counter the mount. They're learning how to lock you down. They're learning how to sweep, just like Moore did. As soon as Perotti got mount, Moore went straight for the sweep. Now Moore goes to mount.
Yep, Moore's got the mount. And
it looks like Perotti's going to scoot out the back door.
Perotti's got to be careful of the triangle choke right here.
There we go again.
Triangle choke opened up. Moore was unable to secure it. I saw him going for it.
Real active ground game, and like you said, if you got two guys that are real active on the ground, you can actually get tired down here. It looks like they're, you know, kind of rolling around. They can't throw a lot of punches. They can't throw elbows like in the pro ranks. But these guys are expending a good amount of energy with their sweeps, with their reversals. Not any submission attempts yet, though, really.
You know, one of the things that excites me most about the growth of mixed martial arts in general is just the fact when you see a competitor going for an armbar there, you know, going for triangle chokes, going for Kimuras, even passing the guard or going to mount, you know, people really react and respond. And you hear the crowd getting up and cheering for that.
Perotti's got a Kimura here if he wants to take it. It looks like he stepped over. He's got side control now, but he had a Kimura there if he wanted to take it.
You know, it really used
actually
to be.
Could be setting up a judo finish armbar there. Decides to go to mount.
That knee on belly is not a good position to be in. He now goes to mount. He's got that arm secured, too, as he see if he's able to do anything from it.
Andy Foster keeping a close eye. Georgia amateur rules, you cannot throw shots to the head. And it's unlikely that Perotti will end this fight with body shots from mount, unless Moore just taps out. Short time in the round. Goes for an arm bar.
Great, beautiful arm bar.
It's a smart thing to do. He's going to roll out of it.
Good reversal. Wow.
Nice scramble. Nice scramble.
Great into the round.
Great into the round, and I'm gonna give Perotti credit for that. Even though he knew it was short time in the round, he knew no matter what happened, he probably wasn't gonna end up in a bad position or sustain any damage from it. So he went ahead and tried to finish the fight with the armbar, and it got in a scramble. Moore ended up on top, but you know he had a solid armbar attempt in there.
I agree completely. I think that round, I think they're even going into this third round. Both gassed out, tired. We're gonna have to see what's gonna happen. You know. Unfortunately, we don't have the high budget to have a jiu-jitsu expert in here like an Eddie Bravo to be able to show us that round score. So we're gonna have to judge it by ourselves. But I think you're right. It's pretty even split. And going into this third round, it's gonna be a war. Both these guys want this fight.
You're not gonna find a lot of amateurs that are as in good a shape as the top of the food chain pro fighters out there. But these guys are in actually pretty good shape. We're going 3 4-minute rounds here, and these guys are expending a lot of energy, and that, you know, they're not staggering in their corners. They're in pretty good shape. Looks like both gyms have got these guys ready.
You know, it's really gonna come down to desire. Immediately locking up to the clinch. Jumping to his guard.
Don't really know what Moore was going. It looked like he might have was going for a bundle throw there, but half-heartedly at best, ends up with Perotti on top. And with as active as Perotti was.
We almost saw it. Was that a go-go Pilates he's going for right there? That's a pretty advanced jiu-jitsu choke that we've only seen Brad Imes, a heavyweight phenom, pull off.
You got to have some amazing dexterity in your legs to be able to pull something like that off.
This round's going to really come down to desire, though, like I was saying. In the last fight, it was Eric Skates. I read a quote on his MySpace, and don't fault me for going and looking at it. He said, the hungry lion hunts the hardest. And that's the truth. These guys are going at it, and, you know, it's just going to come down to desire. In that third round, when you're gassed out, it really is. It's just about heart and how bad you want it.
Perotti needs to posture up here. It looks like Moore's actually looking for a triangle here. Perotti needs to get his head up. He can't lay and pray here. Andy Foster probably will stand him up. There's the posture there. He's getting some good body shots in. The crowd's reacting to it a little bit. But if he lays here, Moore's got jiu-jitsu skills. He's going to look to punch that wrist through and secure a triangle, maybe even switch off to an armbar. He's got a high guard here.
Does. He's got him opened up right here. He's looking to sweep underneath those legs and pass, but he's back down. He needs to really posture up and try to get control of those legs and either a double underpass where he's going to throw those legs up and come around to the cross-side position or just look to strike the body. But like we said, he's not going to finish the fight striking the body, and you really don't want to leave these fights go to the judge's scorecard.
Yeah. I mean, you can't – if you let a fight – Perotti's up there. They warned in the fighters' meeting at the beginning of the fights that you couldn't slam a guy that you had in guard, and that was kind of a gray area there. Moore with another subpar takedown attempt, and Perotti just smothers him with his hips. Now he's in half guard. He's stuffing the knee. We might see a mount position here again with Perotti.
Moore's really got to know that he's got to be in kind of a frantic situation here. Now that he's given up the mount,
yeah,
he doesn't have that much time left.
Whoa, that was a...
Perotti's looking to take the back here, I think.
Yeah, the worst thing Moore could do right now is turn to his stomach, because Perotti can't hit him in the face. He can't hit him with short elbows here. He's not going to sustain a lot of damage. If he gives Perotti his back right here, he's making a big mistake. And he's also giving him an armbar right here. And Perotti's leaning over the armbar trying to secure it. Then he's going to fall back. And Moore's either got to be prepared to sit into the armbar and end up in Perotti's guard, or he needs to get back to mount and try to skate out the back door.
Exactly. He's not looking like he's moving out of this mount right now, though. He's out, and the armbar at the end of the round. There was a tap at the end of the round.
Very good work by Perotti. Very good work. Very excited about his win. Nice finish. Good groundwork. He was patient. He had active passing attempts. Moore just kind of laid there. I think fatigue was a factor. Perotti finished the fight.
Perotti kept that pace up in the third round, was able to secure that mount, and was a little bit more patient this time, and I think that helped him out. He didn't have to worry about the explosion that Moore had in that first round to go and reverse him.
Good fight all the way around, though. Good fight all the way around. Both guys showed potential. They showed good technique, and these guys are only going to improve and come back and put on better fights.
That was a terrific fight. I believe that's, you know, Brody's getting to the point where, you know, he's got to make that choice whether he's going to continue this amateur career or make that turn and go pro. We've got a pro MMA coming up for you. It's pretty exciting. James Fay and Chris Bradshaw. I'm excited to see it.
All right, and our third fight of the night, scheduled for three-minute rounds, and the fight went the distance, mixed martial arts. Judge one saw it 30-27. Judge two saw it 30-27. Judge three saw it 29-28. Unanimous decision, your winner, Carrollton, Georgia, red corner, Daryl Perotti. Red corner, Daryl Perotti, your winner in the third fight of the night. From Top of the Line Fitness, red corner, Daryl Perotti. Let's give a round of applause to Blue Corner Zone, Brian Moore. Good fight. All right, our fourth fight of the night. We turn our attention to the red corner, 33 years of age, at a height of 6'2", 240 pounds, from Decatur, Georgia. Fighting for New Blood Fight Club with a record of 2-1, red corner, James Fade. And his opponent, making his debut professional bout, at 31 years of age, at a height of 6'4", 240 pounds, fighting out of Canton, Georgia, for KO Sports, blue corner, Chris Bradshaw. This is mixed martial arts, again, a professional fight. Scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. Your referee will be Mr. Andy Foster. Welcome to round one, and let's hear it for our Hooters girl.
Welcome everybody to Wild Bill's Fight Night, brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment. Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, also brought to you by No Excuses Sports Nutrition. You can check all that stuff out at noexcusesathletics.com. Atlanta Classic Cars. We're here at Wild Bill's, largest country music bar in the world, I believe. Got a full card full of fights tonight. James Fay versus Chris Bradshaw.
Bradshaw looks focused coming out. James Fay's had a little bit of a layoff. Like, it's been quite a while. Chris Bradshaw, though, is a Gracie Baja affiliate school, fights out of KO Sports.
James Fay's bringing it early. James Fay's bringing it early. Looking at these two guys, you would think James Fay is at a huge disadvantage. He might be at a huge strength disadvantage. Fay's been around for a while. He's been fighting for about 3 or 4 years. He's had limited fights, but he's been training for a while. Let's see if he just takes his time here. You got butterfly guard in.
He's trying to work that overhook, trying to keep that hand.
Bradshaw's looking to get separation and throw blows here.
Faye's almost able to work the sweep
for the guillotine. Nope. Bradshaw's smothering him here.
Bradshaw's switching off, almost like he's trying an anaconda here. Or he's just, he's kind of stuck, trying to stay comfortable with that guillotine.
James Faye just needs to get hand control here. In the pre-fight interviews, Bradshaw said he's going to come out here and leave it all on the mat, which leads me to believe he's got some type of wrestling experience. That's a wrestling term.
That's a pretty big wrestling catchphrase on it.
Yeah. He's doing a good job of controlling the front headlock. Faye's just looking for hand control, trying to fight off that potential guillotine. He's got pretty good hand control here. He just keep that baseball bat and stand up here. Which is that what looks like what Faye's gonna do? Whoa, caught a
catches
knee,
a knee on the way up.
And that's it.
Knee landed flush on the way up.
That's about as close to catching somebody with a knee while they're standing up as you can. And he caught him flush, that's for sure. Drop James Faye.
If James Fay had that one knee on the ground there, then he would have been in a position where it would have been illegal for that blow, and that probably would have ended up in a disqualification.
Yeah, that was inches. That was inches. I don't know if that was timing or just good luck on Bradshaw's part, but got him a W nonetheless.
It looked to me like it's definitely clean, and it is, exactly. Another W on that record, and building him up. The guy's an athletic, tough guy, and he's got my vote. Came out to a tough bagpipe rock kind of anthem there.
No way I'm saying that.
Damn, Fabio's lost a bunch of weight.
Have you seen
do, you're gonna plug it right there.
No, I won't do it. No fucking way.
All right, and our fourth fight of the night in a professional fight, mixed martial arts, scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds.
No way you hear me say athletic.
In the first round, at the 1 minute and 33 second mark, with a KO, a knockout, your winner, blue corner, Chris Bradshaw! Your winner, Chris Bradshaw, with a knockout. Canton, Georgia's own blue corner. Last in, but first up, I'd like to introduce to you in the red corner. He's 20 years of age, 5'6", 145 pounds. He's from Statesville, North Carolina, fighting out of champion Muay Thai with a record of 1 win, no losses. Red corner, Mang Lore. His opponent, fighting out of the blue corner, 38 years of age, 5'8", 145 pounds, from Suwanee, Georgia, fighting out of Team Dojo and Knuckle Up, with a record of 2 wins, only 1 loss, DJ Wiggison. This will be a mixed martial arts amateur bout scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds. And welcome to round one of your fifth fight of the night, Wild Bill's Fight Night. Your referee, Mr. John Sosby.
I'd like to welcome everybody to Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment, Hooters, No Excuses Sports Nutrition. You can check out all their stuff at noexcusesathletics.com. Got our fifth fight of the night, Wiggison Lore, 145-pound amateur MMA.
Wiggison is deceiving from his age, coming out, throwing that left, landed.
Nice leg kicks by Lore, pulling guard here. Wiggison's actually 2-1, he's had a couple fights. Lore making his debut tonight. Wiggison's taking it
down there.
Lore kind of came to the ring nonchalantly, real relaxed.
Wiggison comes to fight. You know, the thing about Wiggison is the guy is 38 years old, but he trains just like he's, you know, he's in his 20s. I mean, he's just a phenom when he's training. He's training with Kazeka right now at Knuckle Up. They brought in a new trainer from out in L.A. The guy's, you know, training with some world-class folks. He's running stadium stairs. I talked to him about his training regimen. He's doing everything he can.
Setting up that arm bar pretty good right now. Lore's got to get active.
He's won this last fight, and the fight before last by armbar off that, too. The guy's, he loves going for a Kimura in this position right here.
It looks like Lore's kind of confused as to what to do right here. And that's one thing that the amateur rules in Georgia have changed. You can't strike to the head in this position. So in this position, you know, the amateur, it looks like he's setting up a triangle here. It's a little bit harder to set up a triangle when you're in mount just because you got to have such a great base to do it. But it looks like Wiggison actually might succeed with his triangle
here. He's almost got it locked. If he's able to pass that arm underneath his leg, then he's able to, he'll be able to secure it. Either that or it can switch off and go for an arm bar. It's a nice thing trying that for mount right
looks
there.
Looks like he's gonna switch off to the arm bar right here and get the tap shortly from Wiggison.
That'll be it.
Wiggison's looking like he's working for the tap. Lore.
Wiggison's giving him an opportunity. Here, he could crank on this, and that would be the end of...
Lore's hanging tough, though. Wiggison doesn't have
Jeez. That arm's about to be hyperextended.
Hey, Lore's got some flexibility in his elbow. Wiggison definitely... He really doesn't need to be crossing his ankles here. He needs to have both legs straight. Lore's actually going to pop his head out. Looks like come out the back door here. He's not getting the proper leverage.
That arm bar was in deep, and Lore's able to have some flexible elbows.
Whoa.
Oh, switch it out right here.
Lore's actually fighting through this.
Lore's striking to the head. Oh!
He's tapping now.
That arm bar's in deep.
He just tapped. The referee didn't see it or thought he was throwing punches. That elbow's looking pretty rough. Lawrence fighting through it.
Not sure why we got the stoppage here. If they're calling it from the armbar, are they going to have the doctor look at it?
Lawrence deducted. They're deducting 1 point from Lawrence because he was kicking Legas into the head, I believe.
That's right. Yeah. There's those heel strikes that he's trying to hammer out. He's trying to frantically get out of that armbar.
Yeah, I think it was more of a reactionary thing. The elbow was clearly hyperextended there, but Lawrence actually improved the situation. And now he's got a clean stand-up, which is, I think, where he wants to be to begin with.
He really does. You know, the guy, he's looking at potentially losing this round 10-8, but, you know, he was in a pretty nasty armbar, and now he's out of it.
Yeah, I'll tell you right now, Lord's thinking one thing right now, and that's don't be on the ground with Wegison.
Wegison's got decent, he's got pretty good stand-up skills, but he's going to look to take this fight to the ground right away.
Yeah, a little knee block there. He's in side control already.
Gonna have the opportunity to take the back here.
And that's gonna be the round.
End of the round.
All Wegison from start to finish. Gonna be a 10-8 round because he was winning the fight, and Lore got a point deduction. Lore out of champion Muay Thai. Talked about they had a couple fighters earlier. Chris Klodfelter, one of their studs coming out of their camp, is gonna be fighting Knuckle Ups, Philip Botha later tonight. Muay Thai rules fight. That should be a great matchup, 165. And then DJ Wegison, local boy, Knuckle Up Fitness Dojo, Team Dojo, just bringing it. He's on a two-fight win streak and looking to make it a three-fight win streak after this fight.
Champion Muay Thai's brought down some tough fighters, but the thing is that, you know, right now in mixed martial arts in Georgia, in the Southeast, really, it's exploded to the point where you've got so many competitive gyms that, you know, you really got to train top-notch and expect these fights to be a war with anybody you step in there with. And you know, they're not going to have any easy fights down here tonight. Nobody is.
Here's start of round two. Wild Bills. Fight night 13. DJ Wegison, Mang Lore. 145 pounds, amateur Muay Thai. And for 38 years old, Wegison's a physical specimen.
Oh, Wegison's
nice,
able to
nice
land a combo.
Nice 1-2 combination. Honestly, that should be an 8 count right now. According to the amateur rules, Lore was clearly hurt. He should have got an 8 count. But he's bringing it. He looks like he's got some good leg kicks. Wegison's taking it to him on his feet.
Wegison's able to just time those jabs. And
might
just,
see a guillotine coming up
without,
here.
Yeah, not a problem at all.
That's going to be tight.
He has the arm in, though, so we'll have to see what happens here. Lore's already proved the fact that he's not going to tap easy.
Yeah, I think it's a tap or snap for Lore, and he chose snap earlier, and he's still in the fight. his elbow was clearly hyperextended, didn't tap, weathered the storm, but he's fighting off a guillotine right now, and it's a little bit harder. He's in a whip-back situation, and Lore's going to tap
it.
There.
There's only so long you can survive without blood going into your brain, and that was a limit for Lore. Another great victory for Wegison, the 38-year-old phenom coming back.
Yeah, that's impressive. 38's a new 20, I guess, and he just showed us just now. He brought it tonight.
Shows a great deal of respect and sportsmanship there with humble in victory, humble, you know, and in his defeats. He's a good guy all around, and I'd like to see him really do well. You know, when you get to know a guy like that, inside the ring, the guy's an animal, but you know what? Once you get outside of here, then he's just a tremendous guy. He's a kid's instructor at his dojo, and I like to see people like that do well.
I guess the question now for Wegison is, when does he turn pro? He's 3-1 as an amateur, dominating performance tonight. Is he doing this just for kicks? Is it a hobby, or does he want to go on up to the pro ranks and test his mettle up there?
I've had some conversations with him, and, you know, I think right now he's pretty satisfied with where he's at. He just loves the competition. He's always around mixed martial arts, and, you know, and that's where he likes to be.
All right, and our fifth fight of the night. In an amateur bout, mixed martial arts scheduled for three-minute rounds. In the second round, 52 seconds in, with a guillotine choke, your winner, blue corner, DJ Wegison. Jay Wiggison from Suwanee, Georgia. Blue corner, your winner with a record now of 3-1. Now leaving the ring, let's give him a round of applause. Red corner, Mang Lord. Right now, I want to introduce to you our fighter that's in the ring. Blue corner, he's 24 years old. He's 6'1", 205 pounds, from Athens, Georgia. Fighting for the Hardcore Gym with no record, debut bout, blue corner, Sam Grizzle. And he's been through a lot out of the dressing room, back in the ring. Let's hear it for him. I'll introduce to you now from the red corner, 27 years old, 5'8", 205 pounds, from Jacksonville, Florida.
The dog was trying to get in.
With a record of also 0-0, debut fight. This one, an amateur bout, scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds. Red corner zone, Sean White. Sean fighting out of the Obaki Dojo and Sam out of the Hardcore Gym. Welcome to round one of your sixth fight of the night, amateur bout, mixed martial arts.
All right, I gotta go to work, I'm getting in my office.
Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, brought to you by Undisputed King of Beers.
We got the promoter here sitting with us. No pressure on you, Nicholas. That's all right. This fight's about to get going. We're not waiting. Sam Grizzle. Oh, man. The guy I've heard has brute strength. Hardcore Gym. I've trained there for the last couple years, and all the heavyweights there say that this guy's been giving him a lot of trouble. He hasn't been training too long.
Good.
He's
hips.
Already got his back.
He's already got his back. He's got both hooks in. He's got tons of time.
This fight's over quick. This fight's going to be over. He's got the rear naked choke. That's it. That's it. Over that quick. Ladies and gentlemen, if you like that, I'll tell you, the Hardcore Gym, you can't get better instruction than Georgia. This guy's only been training a little bit. He's got natural athleticism coming in. But, you know, they can build you into a machine.
Yeah,
that's what
you see Roy Singer there. They got Brian Bowles. WC Phenom. They also got Steven Ledbetter out there. Jeff Bedard trains out there a pretty good bit. Another WC vet. They got a host of guys out there, man. It used to be known for a lightweight school. Had a ton of phenomenal lightweights out there, but all of a sudden now they got a ton of good heavyweights out there.
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. I mean, you can't deny a school that's given, you know, Forrest Griffin the rise from being a University of Georgia police officer and then all the way up to beating Shogun, the number one ranked light heavyweight in the world.
Now he's living the good life, and me and you are sitting here.
This is a great life, though, sitting next to the Wild Bill ringside, though. I'm all about it.
Good fight tonight so far. Grizzle making quick work of it.
I was sitting there staring at Otis, about to say full throttle, and I was like...
Our referee, Andy Foster, will now bring the fighters to the center of the ring. That was mixed martial arts. Again, amateur bout scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds. In the first round at the 22-second mark, with a rear naked choke, your winner, blue corner, Sam Grizzle, Athens, Georgia. Sam Grizzle, blue corner, your winner. As he leaves the ring, let's hear it for red corner, Sean White out of Jacksonville, Florida. Tough break. All right, the first time ever. two women, mixed martial arts at Wild Bill's. In the red corner, 27 years of age, standing 5'8", weighing in at 157 pounds. From Cincinnati, Ohio, fighting out of Cincinnati MMA and Fitness with a record of one win, no losses, a red corner, Rebecca Whitmer. Her opponent, in the blue corner, 19 years of age, 5'9", also weighing in at 157 pounds, from Atlanta, Georgia. Fighting for Team KBX, debut bout, blue corner, Lizzie Miller. Welcome to round one and a first ever mixed martial arts amateur bout, women fighting. Fight number 7 on your fight card. Welcome to Wild Bill's Fight Night.
All right. Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment, Hooters, No Excuses Sports Nutrition. You can check out all their stuff at noexcusesathletics.com. First female MMA bout in Georgia on record.
This actually, I believe we've had a few in Dalton and some outside kind of peripherally. This is, I think, the first one
at
in
Wild
Atlanta.
Bill's Fight Night?
Technically in Atlanta.
In Atlanta.
Yeah. I think that's how we're categorizing it, but definitely the first one at Wild Bill's Fight Night. We've had Muay Thai here.
Lizzie Miller has the entire state of Georgia in here cheering her on tonight. It was deafening when they introduced her just a minute ago.
I've never heard a reaction like that to an introduction.
You don't even have that many fans, Kyle.
Kyle
Maynard, Cliff Fretwell here with you.
I can tell you I wouldn't want to go up and fight one of these girls. I think they look focused and they look ready to go. This is exciting to see. You know, this is another thing with the growth of the sport. More people getting involved. Everybody's got the right to be able to do it.
Miller fighting out of local gym, Team KBX. And Whitmer coming all the way from Cincinnati, Ohio. She's coming out firing, though.
Throwing some body kicks.
They're going to exchange some kicks here.
Lizzie answering.
Looks like neither one of these girls want to be on the ground at all right now. Nice inside leg kick.
Lizzie's had some background, I believe, on some Muay Thai before.
Miller's
just in.
Walking straight through everything Whitmer's got. Nice knees.
Good work from the clinch.
Both guys hitting pretty
Lizzie
good bit of knees
active,
in there.
Staying active, trying to get that control there. Going off, switching off to a guillotine here. She's got it locked up in between.
Whitmer,
see if she can go to her guard.
Whitmer's doing the right thing.
She's trying
standing
to the standing guillotine.
Guillotine
right here. That's almost it.
That's
she's got her picked
hard
up.
To defend.
Whitmer's gonna drop down and try to pass with a double leg here or something or drop back in her back.
She just pulls guard here. It could be over.
She's not out yet. That's
there
all
was.
Over.
Whitmer tapped. Miller with a quick ending to the fight there with a guillotine choke. Lizzie Miller.
Miller's got
Team
a
KBX.
Huge reaction over here.
You guys can hear the crowd.
Wow.
Everybody's going crazy.
It's an uproar in here. Good for her.
Pandemonium. KBX opened up, I'd say, about a year plus ago, year and a half ago, maybe 2 years ago. They've been putting out some quality guys.
Marshall Davis, that instructor over there at KBX, is a top-notch coach. You know, they specialize in the Krav Maga and Alpharetta, but they developed a solid MMA program.
Well, Lizzie Miller definitely looks to be at top of the food chain in women's MMA here down here in Georgia.
Yeah, it'll be fun to see if we can get some more, more faces across from her to stand out there. You know, just like they said before, it was, you know, in the pre-fight interview, it's tough to get women to commit to the fights. You know, there's not that much in the competition, so they have to match these fights with big weight differences.
If I was in Lizzie Miller's weight class after seeing that, I don't know if I'd want to fight her either.
All right, our first time ever, we're going to have these girls join our referee, Andy Foster, in the center ring. Again, a first in Wild Bill's mixed martial arts amateur bout, scheduled for three-minute rounds, our seventh fight of the night. Your winner, 54 seconds into round one with a guillotine choke from Atlanta, Georgia, blue corner, Lizzie Miller! Lizzie Miller, blue corner, debut bout, walks away with a win 54 seconds into the first round. Congratulations to Lizzie in the blue corner. Let's hear it for red corner's Rebecca Whitmer from Cincinnati, Ohio. Tough break. All right, this is scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. Professional bout, mixed martial arts. Let's meet our fighter in the red corner, 32 years of age, 5'11", 170 pounds, from Jacksonville, Florida, fighting out of the Obaki Dojo with a record of 0 wins, 4 losses, red corner, Josh Rutgers. Josh up against the hometown boy, blue corner, 27 years of age, 6 foot, 170 pounds, from Kennesaw, Georgia. Fighting for Knuckle Up, with a record of 3 wins, 1 loss, blue corner, Kennesaw zone, Clay Harbison. Again, a professional bout, mixed martial arts, scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. Welcome to round one, brought to you by Hooters. Back into the action, fight 8, fight night 13.
All right, Wild Bill's fight night 13, brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment, Hooters, No Excuses Sports Nutrition. You can check out all that stuff at NoExcusesAthletics.com.
Andy Foster, your referee for this fight.
Clay Harbison's looking hungry.
Yeah, Harbison Rutgers. Hometown boy Clay Harbison.
You know, Rutgers, don't let the record fool you. It's 0-4, but the guy's been fighting with Tim Catalfo since 99. You can't be in the gym that long and not learn something.
Yeah,
you know?
Tim Catalfo is definitely going to have his guys ready. I hope Harbison doesn't take this guy lightly. Does he keep his hands up? Good motion and pick this guy apart.
Harbison's really well-rounded. The guy's a former soccer player, athletic, and then he kind of met Steve Hedden and came into the world of jiu-jitsu.
Flying armbar attempt. Harbison's elbows past the cup. He's okay. Rutgers bringing it, though.
Rutgers is bringing a weird got a little scramble game here. Hey, Clay's an athletic guy to scramble with, man. He's got great jiu-jitsu and solid hands, too.
Yeah, looks like if Rutgers is going to pull out the win here, he's going to have to gut a win out.
You see Rutgers' face after he lost, he didn't connect on that high kick, wasn't really too pleased with himself. He's eating some shots.
Yeah, Cliff Fretwell, Kyle Maynard here. Wild Bill's Fight Night 13 brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment. Middle of round one here. Harbison's really taking it to Rutgers. Almost at his back right here. He's throwing some elbows in the back. He's got to keep him off the spine. Knee bar attempt there by Rutgers. Harbison's just smothering him with punches right now.
Harbison's only got to be careful of hitting the back of the head of the spine, like you mentioned. Other than that, he's in solid control in this back pressure right here.
He needs to just go ahead and throw his hooks in right here, or at least control a far wrist and get his left knee in.
He seems content right now with just standing here and taking
shots. Rutgers tapped. Rutgers tapped.
Wow.
Rutgers overmatched from the bell. Overmatched from the bell. Took the fight on short notice, but just was overmatched from the get-go.
fighter out of the ring. This will be a no-brainer. Andy Foster, our referee, bringing our fighter into the center ring. Professional bout scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. Get the exact time at exactly a minute 37 into the first round. Your winner due to a tap out from strikes. Blue corner, Clay Harbison. Kennesaw, Georgia, knuckle up. Clay Harbison, blue corner, your winner with a record now of 4-1. Your ninth fight of the night for Wild Bill's Fight Night 13. Right now, we'll meet Red Corner, 28 years of age, 5'8", 212 pounds, from Jacksonville, Florida, from the Obaiki Dojo, with a record of 3 wins, 1 loss, Red Corner, Tony Souza. His opponent, fighting out of the blue corner, 29 years of age, 212 pounds, standing 5'10", from Hinesville, Georgia. He's an independent with also 3 wins and 1 loss. Blue corner, Willie Smalls. It's pro mixed martial arts, so it's scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. Welcome to round one, brought to you by Hooters and Heineken. Andy Foster will be your referee again. Professional bout, mixed martial arts, scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. It's Fight 9 at Wild Bill's Fight Night. Let me hear you scream. Both fighters with a record of 3-1.
Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment, Hooters, No Excuses Sports Nutrition. And check out all their stuff at noexcusesathletics.com. Tony Souza, Willie Smalls, both weighed in at 212 pounds. Willie Smalls looking to bring it early. I'm Cliff Fretwell here along with Kyle Manning.
Willie Smalls is throwing some bombs. Tony Souza's got to weather the storm. He's got to weather the storm and pull him into his guard and
Tony
bring him Souza, down.
Tony Souza's well arsed on the ground. He's been training Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu for a long time.
You have to be worried about the ref stopping this. With Willie throwing those strikes, he's got to get to the point. The guy is just an athlete, former arena football player, extremely athletic.
Whoa!
Willie, you know, if you could describe his style.
I think Souza might have gotten rocked by one of those shots.
NFL. I mean, he just tries to bulldog people straight through him.
He's being real physical in this first round.
Souza's
for sure.
Going for a heel hook right here.
He might have it.
He's almost got it.
Smalls is just going to stay there. And
I can tell Smalls is one of those guys
didn't quite
that
have it.
He would rather give up his knee than lose this fight.
Souza's still got that heel hook if he wants to attempt it. He's got to get Willie's hips to the ground though. Willie's based up here. He's not going to finish that heel hook there. Tony did take this fight on short notice. He's kind of one of those gym rat kind of guys, always training, so he's probably in pretty good shape, even though he did take the fight on short notice.
You know, I know Tony's definitely, as far as technique goes, he's definitely got the upper hand here. Caught him with an uptick on the way down. But Willie is just so athletic and so powerful. He's dangerous. Good friend of mine, pro fighter Dave Newborn got the
only win against Willie.
He does have the only win against Willie, and it was by a triangle choke. And honestly, going into that, I was scared for Dave. Because Willie's just not one of those guys that you want to fight. He's just naturally athletic and just a tough dude.
We got him on our lap here. He's that guy that he brings it and he gets you out of your game. He gets you out of your game plan. He pushes the pace. He roughs you up. He's kind of unorthodox. He never slows down. And that's kind of what's happening with Tony right now. And if Tony don't watch out, he's going to get guillotined right here.
I think Willie's going to have to look to finish the strike.
He better secure that arm. He better secure that left arm right there. Tony's got a good angle on that arm. All he's got to do is skate his hips out. He's looking to throw that right leg over Willie's head.
And some top elbows. Tony's doing a good job. He's all right defending himself here.
Tony's eating a little bit of damage, but not as bad and as flush of shots as he was taking earlier. Willie has not slowed down for the last three minutes of this round.
Tony's got to do a better job, and he's got to secure an overhook here. Slow this pace down.
Tony needs a tie-up wrist here.
He took some heavy shots on the ground there, and it's taking a second for him to get up.
Tony's slow to get up here. They're going to reset in the center.
Willie Smalls is not the type of guy that you want to be underneath.
Tony's taking his time here. You can tell he's obviously tired. I don't think he expected that kind of pace coming out of the blocks from Willie. Willie's ready to go on this restart. Our referee, Andy Foster, wants to get a ruling on this cut. I think Tony's got a cut over his nose. It's below the eyes. I don't know if it really warranted being stopped. Usually you only stop a cut, A, if it's real deep and bleeding heavily, and B, if it's above the eye and can blur his vision. And that was neither in that case.
Definitely not. That was a good call. Dr. Traub, our doctor for the evening, I mean, he's been around wrestling and, you know, combat sports his whole life, and he knows when to see that.
Tony switches Tony's really got to
slow this pace down a little bit.
It looks like he might have blown his wad defending off all those shots against Willie early on.
He definitely hasn't. He's still coming with just as much force. You'd think that a guy throwing that many bombs, I mean, would tire himself out. But he's just so powerful. If you look at the size of this guy's back, you know, if you sat us next to each other, I don't think we're going to get half of that.
No, not at all. But it looks like tough. And
we have 10 seconds left in this round. He's got to survive this.
Believe it or not, well, he's got a triangle here.
He has a triangle. I don't see him finishing that, though, with a couple seconds left.
Yeah, I think Tony's just been content to hold on, not take any more damage this round. But I'm actually a little surprised that I don't know what's going on here. Looking for another restart.
Another restart.
I don't know why
they
restart. They clapped for 10 seconds left in the round. And they're starting right back in the position they just were. I don't really understand what Andy Foster was doing there. He actually put Willie in a situation to tighten this triangle a little bit.
Yeah, he did, actually. I mean, that was that, you know.
I was kind of surprised that Willie didn't defend it a little bit more vehemently. And he's just pouring it on Tony.
I just don't think that Willie feels any threat right now. I mean, Tony is a technician. And, you know, but the guy's going to have trouble against a strength guy. You know, Tony's finished a ton of fights by armbar, but that's a difficult thing to do with a guy who's got,
you know. It'll be a huge upset if Willie Smalls finishes fight by submission.
It would be.
Tony's.
This is where Tony wants to be. This is a position Tony could definitely end this fight right here.
Tony needs to get his hooks in. He really needs to get his hooks in. He needs to get his hooks in and finish this fight. Mouthpiece is out.
Rear naked choke to fly. That's it. He's going out. He's going
out. Taps.
That was a war. That, what a comeback. That is true inspiration right there.
Gut check for Tony Sosa. We thought there was a little bit of time left in the round. Come to find out we had more. We had a restart. Next thing you know, Tony Sosa gets Willie Smalls back in a scramble and chokes him out for the win. I mean, if you look at it, Tony Sosa's face is mangled right now. He took a ton of damage in that first round.
He came out on top, though. That's what true heart will do for you.
He got the W. He hung in there. He weathered the storm, and he got the W. Willie Smalls brought it.
He's paid a price for that win, but he deserves it.
Absolutely. Full Throttle 13. Wild Bill's Fight Night 13 brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment.
Andy Foster will now bring both fighters to the center ring. Doctors checked them out. We're good to go for the announcement. Need both fighters, if possible, to the center. Again, a professional mixed martial arts scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. In the first round, at the 4:35 mark, with a rear naked choke, your winner, red corner, Jacksonville, Florida, Tony Souza. Tony Souza, your winner from Jacksonville, Florida, red corner. Tough fight. Let's hear it for blue corner, Willie Smalls from Hinesville, Georgia. All right, let's meet our fighters. In the red corner, 28 years of age, 5'9", 160 pounds from Statesville, North Carolina. Fighting out a champion, Muay Thai, with a record of 8-6. Red corner, Chris Klotfelter. And his opponent in the blue corner, Southeastern Regional Champion, ISKA. 35 years of age, 5'9", 160 pounds, Marietta, Georgia's own, fighting out of Knuckle Up, blue corner, champion, Philip Botha. With a record in 7-1. Again, this is Muay Thai, scheduled for 5 3-minute rounds. Dennis Palmer will be your referee. Welcome to round one of our only Muay Thai fight of the night. Let's hear it for these two fighters. Philip Botha, the champion, blue corner, versus Chris Klotfelter, red corner.
All right, Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, Full Throttle Entertainment. Sponsored by Hooters, No Excuses Sports Nutrition. You can check out all their stuff at noexcusesathletics.com. Philip Botha, Chris Klotfelter, these guys are no stranger to the ring whatsoever. Chris Klotfelter is actually a fairly accomplished pro MMA fighter as well. Philip Botha is mainly stuck to the kickboxing and pro boxing. He's undefeated in pro boxing. I think he's 6-0 as a pro boxer.
6-0 there as a pro boxer. 19-8 as a pro Muay Thai.
Both are firing down the middle off a leg kick from Klotfelter. I know the fans probably want some more MMA, but they're gonna get a lot of action here with this fight.
Yeah, this is not a lackadaisical pace that these guys, both of these guys go and take to their fights. You know, you're gonna see some snapping kicks there too. Both are leading with that hook coming in. He seems to be throwing that right hand just vicious, trying to take off Klotfelter's head right
inside
away.
Side leg kick by Botha.
Oh.
Traditionally in Muay Thai fights, first round, guys are going to feel each other out. They're going to throw more of their leg kicks in the first round because later in the rounds, your legs are a little bit more beat up. Your movement's not there as much. So look to guys to throw a little bit more leg kicks. Nice Superman punch by Klotfelter. Grazed off the cheek of Botha.
Claude Felter's content with kind of staying in a little counter-punching pace here, letting Botha go and pursue him here.
Botha needs to jump on him. After he backs him up, Botha needs to jump on him.
Yeah, that's the thing, is he's leaving the range open in the distance, and I think that Botha's going to have a better chance once he closes it there. He's a pretty big for the weight class. Clodfelter's a strong guy too, but Botha needs to go in and kind of work in towards that clinch.
Yeah, Clodfelter's definitely not a 170-pounder. He's 170 for this fight, and it was probably a catch weight for him and Botha, but Clodfelter's fought as low as 155 in MMA. So he's definitely the smaller guy here, but Botha, he just, nice spinning round kick.
Botha answers with that inside leg.
They're setting a pretty good pace here in the first round. Clodfelter keeps dropping his hands on those leg kicks, though, trying to catch a leg kick. He just needs to check them and fire right back down the pipe.
Nice Superman punch again.
Nice.
Landing it. Clodfelter, when he's got distance here, he looks a lot more comfortable. He doesn't want to be pressed, it looks like, which is weird for a guy who's got, you know, 7 pro MMA fights. You'd think that he'd be real comfortable in that clinch, but seems to be wanting to keep that distance away from Botha.
Well, like I said, the size is obvious. You can see the size is obvious. He probably doesn't want Phillip plumb clinching him, hanging on his head and tiring him out. The best thing to do is make Phillip chase him. Maybe Phillip tires himself out chasing him. He counterpunches, and he picks his spots. Very active pace.
Very nice inside leg kick by Phillip. It was kind of an answer to that head kick that Clodfelter's throwing. Clodfelter's, they're both these guys are going for the finish. I think we're going to see a knockout here.
Both of these guys are Wild Bill's Fight Nights veterans. They both fought on multiple Wild Bill's Fight Night cards. Clodfelter, Muay Thai, and MMA. Nice shot down the middle and a good round. Clodfelter falls over.
You know, that's not something that you really want to display to your opponent, is your fatigue like that. You know, really, ideally, you want to, you know, like both of them went down there really relaxed and, you know, hustle to your counter, hustle back. It sets the tone mentally. Botha knows that he might be gassing out now, and it's going to up the pace for him, give him more confidence going into this.
At first, it looked like he slipped, and then he just laid there after that. I don't know if he injured his leg or ankle or knee, or if that was just exhaustion in the pace of the first round. Four-time world Muay Thai champ Kumpan Dikempau is in Phillip Botha's corner. This guy is no stranger to Muay Thai. This guy's no stranger to Lapini Stadium. This guy is Muay Thai. What better guy to have in your corner in a Muay Thai fight than Kumpan Dikempau? I've trained with him since I began my MMA career, and he's a great coach and a great trainer. I'm sure he gave Phillip some much-needed advice.
Kumpan's definitely... the guy's got a wealth of experience and just, you know, widely respected. He's actually in the gym today, and some guys came in looking for him just to see where he worked out.
Right.
He wasn't there, but they just wanted to see him just to show their respect.
He's definitely an asset to have down here in the Southeast. Back to the fight, though. Clodfelter's staying on his counterpunch, which I think is smart. He whelped up both his left leg a little bit with those leg kicks in the round. If you see right above the left knee, he's actually stuck to those leg kicks, and he might actually be able to slow both his movement down here in the second round.
Yeah, you see those, that redness there really shows that, you know, some guys show damage different. You see both is throwing more inside leg kicks, and you see some damage towards the inside of Clodfelter's legs, but both these guys, it's going to be hard for them to keep this pace throughout the entire fight. You know, eventually one of these guys is going to tire, start to drop their hands, and then that's when we see one of those rights connect or a head kick connect from Clodfelter, and, you know,
These guys' position and their movement's been pretty good so far. But like you said, it looks like it's going to be a position battle as well. One of these guys gets tired, their hands drop, make a mistake. He's going back to that leg kick. Clodfelter feels comfortable throwing that right leg kick, or right head kick with the right leg.
Botha loading up, didn't pull the trigger. He's actually a 2007 World Shotokan champion. He's had a lot of success lately. The guy's been on fire.
He's been on fire lately.
He's been competing since 91, I believe, and a former South African Special Forces operative. And
he caught Clodfelter with a right hook. He's been throwing that right hook heavy, and it finally connected. I don't know if Klotfelter's going to beat the bell on this one.
That landed right on Klotfelter's face. I mean, it was perfect. Fight's over. Impressive victory for Philip Botha.
Impressive victory. He was patient. He stalked Klotfelter. He staved off the leg kicks. He staved off the head kicks. And threw that right hand, that right hook with bad intentions, and it landed.
Highlight real KO. Botha retains his belt. Klotfelter is having trouble sitting down on the stool there. Hopefully we'll see him back in the ring though soon. The guy's a very tough competitor, whether it's an MMA or Muay Thai. I look forward to seeing him soon.
Yeah, both these guys are consummate professionals. You're going to see him again for sure.
To the center ring. That was a Muay Thai fight, again scheduled for 5 at 3-minute rounds. In the second round, your winner at 1 minute and 54 seconds, and still holding the Southeastern Regional title, your champion, Philip Botha, blue corner, Marietta, Georgia. Fighting out of Knuckle Up, your champion, Philip Botha. Let's hear a quick round of applause also for Red Corner, Chris Klotfelter. Thank you. Both fighters waiting to come into the ring. Now coming in from the red corner, let's hear it for Will Mora. Now entering the ring, blue corner, Sam Holloway. Gonna now meet the fighters. Red corner, 26 years of age, 6'3", 250 pounds from Statesville, North Carolina. Fighting out of Champion Muay Thai with a record of 7-3. Red corner, Will Mora. His opponent in the blue corner, 29 years of age, 6'4", 245 pounds. From Marietta, Georgia, fighting for the Hardcore Gym, also with a record of 7-3, blue corner, Sam Holloway. Mixed martial arts scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. Andy Foster, your referee, welcome to round one, brought to you by Hooters. It's your 11th fight of the night, mixed martial arts, fight 11, Wild Bill's fight night. At this time, Andy Foster, the referee, we cannot fight, even though we're at high speed, obviously, until our doctor, who is with one of the fighters, is ringside. We may not start the fight until our doctor is ringside, so we're standing by. A little music, DJ Dan, before we get this 11th fight started. I do apologize. doctor's ringside. Here we go. Fight 11, Wild Bill's Fight Night.
All right, Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment, Hooters, Atlanta Classic Cars, and Flood Brothers. Sam Holloway, Will Mora.
I'm Kyle Minard, sitting here with Cliff Fretwell, Pro MMA.
250 pounds? This guy's going to be throwing some heavy
leather. I thought you were saying you're 250 pounds.
No, I'm okay. Not 250 pounds.
Maybe if we sat on the scale together.
I am a shredded 155 pounds. Sam Holloway coming out looking for the takedown.
Sam's got it. Sam's a tough Division II wrestler in college, All-American, I believe, and Pennsylvania.
Fighting out of a hardcore gym.
He's a tough guy. He's trained for this fight hard. I think that he's going to have a lot of success here. But Will Moore, too, I've seen him fight plenty of times here. He's no stranger to the Wild Bills ring.
He's definitely had some wars here in the ring at Wild Bills. He's definitely a Wild Bills veteran. Sam Holloway's actually a veteran in MMA all over Georgia. Fought a couple times in the Southeast. I actually fought on a card with him when he fought UFC vet Kevin Jordan in Alabama. He's been around for a while. He's no stranger to the ring.
That was in 2003, right?
Yeah, that was
a while ago. Sam
was a minute ago.
Sam's been around for a while. So have you. That's why I'm glad to have your expertise here. This has been an amazing night of fights so far. We've seen some tough finishes, some brutal fights, and I think that this one's going to be no different.
We've definitely seen some world-class grappling. We've seen 38-year-old physical specimens tonight, and Sam Holloway's trying to put it together. He's half guard. He's got half the hardcore gym in his corner, Rory Singer.
He's going for a knee bar.
Switched up to it. Nice. I don't know if he's got...
Will doesn't seem to have the torque on it. Either that or he's just toughing
Will's
it
just
out.
Will's just going to kick out of it.
Sam's going to retain that top position.
Yeah, he's going to try to stay on top here. He's got to look for those up kicks, though.
Our matchmaker, Dave Oblas, likened Sam Holloway to an Abercrombie model. I told Sam about that. He got a good laugh out of it. He's definitely... Because Sam's always showing up to these fights in decent condition, but... He's finally refocused himself to the point where he's committed. He's training all the time. The dude's shredded. And, you know, seeing a guy with that technique when he's got all the physical tools in place is a force.
But he really needs to be active here. Will slowed his pace down, and Sam really needs to pick the pace up. It's about halfway through the first round, and I think if he picks the pace up, makes Will move on his back a little bit more, Will A, tire himself out, and B, open up a submission. He's got a chance to throw some elbows here right now.
He does, and he's probably going to work these short elbows right here from the top side, from this cross side position. Sam is a bear, and he's not going to give up the top position too easily. His wrestling background, he's not going to give it up.
Absolutely. He's looking to cut Will here and end the fight, but he's also got a hammerlock here if he wants to take it. And he can just switch from elbows to hammerlock. He really should try to keep that left hip of his down, pin his arm down. This is classic. Matt Hughes kind of made this this situation pretty popular. It's kind of a crucifix position in wrestling, and you can really punish a guy right here. He can't defend himself, and you can really chop him up good with your elbows. This is pro MMA, 3 5-minute rounds. Wild Bill's Fight Night 13. Cliff Fretwell here with Kyle Maynard here ringside with you.
Sam's got that Kimura locked up again. Will is.
He needs to get it.
It'll snap before it taps, just like you said before. I mean, it's, you know, that is in deep.
You can see the pain on Wilmore's face here.
The strain on the elbow, too, if you see that elbow hyperextended like that.
Sam's just going to switch back from elbows to Kimura's, and that's what you want to do here. You want to wear the guy out. You want to frustrate him. He leaves that arm hanging, and you lock it up good.
No, likely. I mean, this is like your opinion.
He's got it tight now.
Oh, my God.
Wilmore's powering out of it. Looked like the elbow was ready to go right there for a second.
Unbelievable. Sam Holloway's doing everything he can to crank on that Kimura, and he can't seem to finish it. Should he step over the head there and give up that cross?
No, he's
position?
In a great position right now. I'm a big fan of the side mount position. I think it's really underrated. A lot of guys don't capitalize on it. He should switch from elbows to Kimura's, but he's also missing his right knees. His corner's yelling for him to throw right knees to the body right here, and he totally could. There you go. He's starting to listen to his corner, but he don't want Moore to scoot out the back door, so to speak,
exactly.
Right there.
Those right knees, you have to open up space, and, I mean, that's all grappling is either creating space or taking it away. Sam's got a chance here to mount or take his back. Looks like he's going.
He can finish it right here. He can finish it right here. He's got a little bit of time. Moore's throwing from his back. He's not going to go quietly. Nice shot from the bottom by Will Moore. He needs to pin the arms to the side and just try to finish it here.
Oh, that's in deep, too.
He can't seem to finish it. Will's weathering the storm off his back.
Looks like we've got close to the end of the round.
Sam switches up to an arm bar.
Moore's pass that elbow.
No harm, no foul there at the end of the round, though. Bell to bell, Sam Holloway controlled the round. Now, Kyle, if you're in Will Moore's corner, what are you telling him right now?
Yeah, I think that he needs to keep it on the feet. As hard as it's going to be, keeping Sam from taking you down, he really needs, I've seen a stand up before, he needs to stay on the feet. Champion Muay Thai is known for their kickboxing. You know, he's just showing that he's not up to Sam's level on the ground.
Yeah, Coach Davis probably definitely got him prepared on his feet. If I'm in Will's corner, I'm telling him the same thing. Sprawl and brawl.
Exactly.
This guy's a wrestler. I'm sure they trained that in their training camp leading up to this fight. He knew they were fighting Sam Holloway. He knew the guy's a wrestler. So, you know, don't throw careless kicks. Don't overcommit to your punches and don't over-pursue him, because that's going to open up for a takedown.
And heavyweights will, you know, oftentimes do that. You know, honestly, too, Will looks like he's coming to this fight and dropped quite a bit of weight from previous fights.
Yeah, he has lost quite a bit of weight.
But he's still got.
And Sam's going straight for that double leg again.
Sam's brought him down here.
He's going to cut that right leg up the middle and look to get side control again.
Previously,
Sam's doing a good job of circling back to the center of the mat.
Sam's been on a he's been on a two fight losing streak now, but it's been to Hollis Gracie. You know, who's really one of the heirs of the Gracie family as far as jiu-jitsu goes. I mean, the Abu Dhabi level grappler and lost him in the IFL. And then you've got Antoine Britt, who just threw some nasty shots here at a Wild Bills fight and stopped the fight.
Sam sneaking in those little right-handed uppercuts there.
Looks like we got a little bit of blood coming down from, I believe it's Will Moore's nose here.
He's trying to trap that arm behind his head and then shoot those uppercuts. I'd really like to see Sam being a little bit more active to pass the guard here, though. His jiu-jitsu skills are great. He's training with a great gym, a hardcore gym up there in Athens. And I'd really like to see him get side control again. And I think at this point in the fight, Wilmore's been fighting off his back and fighting submissions for so long, he might give it up.
You gotta wonder how long he can hold his Kimura off, you know?
He's got tight.
That is looking like he's got it in tight again, and Sam's a powerful guy. Oh, that elbow's hyperextending. That's going.
Will Moore is doing a good job of just weathering the storm and trying to retain a little bit of position here.
I hope you all have a good enough view of this with a, you know, this elbow and how far that's been going out as we do. It is absolutely, he's got to have some damage to it. I can't imagine him not. I mean, the only saving grace that he's had is just that enormous bicep Will Moore has got.
Yeah. Holloway needs to throw elbows. Holloway needs to throw elbows right here. Almost without caution. He's in a great position. He's got a great base. He just needs to fire elbows down the middle, straight punches down the middle, and just stay busy here, and he'll finish Will Moore. Will Moore needs to skate his hips away, cut a knee up the middle, and try to just retain guard and protect himself at this point. Sam Holloway needs to posture up and throw blows right here, which is what he's doing.
Exactly. He doesn't want to create him too much space. If he controls those hands, he comes down with some heavy shots. Rope's kind of getting away right here from the grappling, but he's still able to land some nasty shots.
He's firing him down
this
the middle
now. This could be it.
As we were talking earlier in the evening, mount is kind of overrated these days because guys can get out it, but you notice Sam is keeping a high mount. He's keeping his knees in the armpits, and therefore when Moore bridges up, there's nothing to bridge into. Sam's all the way up on his chest, and he's bridging into air.
Sam might be looking at an arm triangle that's opening up here, trying to pull the arm across the head. I don't know. He might be content with staying at the mount. See a little bit of a cut opening up over Moore's right eye. If that blood gets in the eye, and we could look, you know, it'd be grounds for a stoppage. But that going for that same side Kimura again, that arm has just got to be
It's taking a beating. Cliff Fretwell, Kyle Maynard, Wild Bills Fight Night 13, brought to you by Hooters. Full Throttle Entertainment. Got Sam Holloway and Will Mora pro MMA, 3 5-minute rounds, 250-pound weight class, heavyweight guys.
These are the big boys, and they're Sam Holloway is definitely exhibiting some world-class grappling here. He's this is a guy that can compete at any level. I mean, he gave Hollis Gracie a run for his money until Hollis was able to mount him, land a few strikes, and take his back. But the guy's competed against the Kevin Jordans. After that, he's on a 5-fight win streak, and we'll have to see if he's able to finish him. I've got a lot of respect for Will Moore hanging in here.
Yeah, he's surviving at this point. It's been all Sam Holloway. And Sam really needs to, like I said, be a little less cautious at this point and really starting to look to do some damage, because Will's in survival mode and he's not really in reversal mode at this point. And there you go. Sam's starting to posture up. He's really starting to land some heavy blows. And he keeps that
Moore's
high mount.
To buck. As soon as he does, he's coming back down.
He keeps that high mount.
Without that, should he keep attacking this Kimura if he hasn't had that much success with it?
He actually should switch off to an armbar right now. The Kimura's
exactly.
Not there, but he could switch off to an armbar right here as long as he secures it before he goes back with it, which is a big mistake. A lot of guys rush an armbar and fall back before they got it. If he doesn't rush it, it's there for the taking right now.
No, if he switched off to the side here and was able to take that arm, he'd have all day to sit there, let Moore tire his arm out before he settled back and took it.
Right. Short time again. Sam's
there he goes,
going for that arm bar again. If Sam arches right here, it's over. And Moore survives another arm bar at the end of another round. His elbows are going to be a little tore up at the end of this fight.
Moore is going to have to look for a finish here in this next round. He's in a tough spot. His corner's going to have to tell him just to go out there. Now you can't, no pun intended, hold any punches. He's got to go out. He's got to throw everything
absolutely.
He can.
Absolutely. Absolutely. If I'm in Moore's corner, I'm like, you got to go out there and look for the knockout. You're surviving on the ground. You're not really getting any damage. You're not putting yourself in a position to finish him with any submissions. You got to knock this guy out.
On the flip side of that too, Sam Holloway, he needs to get, I think stay straight with that game plan.
Same with the game plan.
Take him down and pound him out.
Lower your level, blast double, take him down, work your ground game, and try to finish him. I'm sure Roy Singer's giving him some good advice and saying, hey, the hammer locks and the Kimuras, all those arm locks and the key locks and all that stuff aren't there anymore.
He needs to go for something a little bit more.
You need
high
to go
percentage.
For an arm bar. You just need to start posturing up and blasting down the middle and finish the guy.
Both guys got a little bit of swelling over their right eyes, and we haven't seen hardly any exchanges on the
feet.
Here's
our double leg again. He switches off to a single. Nice change off.
He's past the guard right
got
here.
Got side control here.
This is one of my favorite passes, actually, is the fake it. Let the guy go ahead and grab the guillotine choke and then just pass the guard. He's got no power here holding it down. Moore's just only tiring himself out even further.
Yep.
Sam's going to look to base up here. He's got to go back to a little bit more active. Ideally, he's been dominant on the ground, and some of these rounds have been, even borderline close to 10-8.
Yeah.
But I think
last round could have been. He inflicted some damage. He had his arms in trouble quite a few times.
He did, just off of those percentage. The submission attempts that he had going.
Yeah, a lot of judges aren't going to give you a 10-8 unless you just really got blasted in a round.
Damage, right.
And almost got ended. But that's kind of what we were talking about earlier about hitting a submission just for the sake of trying to score good graces in the judges' eyes and actually trying to finish the fight. Every submission Sam Holloway's thrown in this fight has been with intentions to finish the fight.
Exactly.
It's not been to get anybody to get more to change position. It's been to finish the fight. And that's what judges want to see.
Like that powerful gets a hold of your arm, then you don't really have a choice. That's why I have a great deal of respect for Will Moore to be able to survive this north-south barrage, cross-eyed, the mounted attack. Even taking us back for just a brief second, it's...
Sam could actually try to a choke there from the north-south position. I'd like to see him get off his knees and put a little bit more weight on Will Moore and make him carry his weight a little bit more. He's being kind of nice here, being up on his knees. I think he's trying to secure that arm bar, but Moore's got his elbow down below Holloway's cup, so the arm bar's not there.
I think for Sam's sake, at this point, if he's able to keep him down here... his biggest opponent right now is finishing this fight. If
right.
he stays on the ground, I don't believe that Moore is going to have a chance to go and put Sam in any danger. Now, if for some reason, they scramble and go up to the feet. Moore's got a chance to knock him out here, but yeah. Moore needs to work for these finishes.
Moore's just clamping down right here. Holloway's got a high mount. That's good technique. He got him. He's got him in a bad position right now. You know, he needs to posture up, bring down those elbows.
See some more activity.
Yeah. If Sam would just go with a couple bursts and then rest, and a couple bursts and rest, I think after a couple bursts, he's going to finish more. How's a solid shot down the middle.
You know, I honestly don't think that it's Sam's cardio that's keeping him from posturing up here and finishing that. I think he's set and going for
back
that Camaro.
More again. I think Sam could just finish him with punches right now, and he's trying to finish him with his Camaro.
You know, Sam might try and step across here and tighten that up a little bit. He's in the position where, you know, giving up that mount, you know, it's not necessarily the best thing to do, but
Sam's corner's calling for punches right now, and like I said, I think he can finish this fight with punches.
Well, with a barrage of elbows and punches from that top mounted position, Moore is shown that he's trying his hardest to try to buck out of this, and, you know,
right.
Elbow escape, Upa escape, but it's just not happening. Sam's a big guy, big muscular guy to be on top of you, and, you know, he's not relenting at all with the pressure that he's putting on Moore.
Got a decent little up elbow in right there. He slipped a little elbow in. If he just stayed in this posture position, high mount, I think he can finish Will Moore. He's not exploding up and getting like several clean punches in. His corner's calling for him to finish the fight. He goes back to the Kimura again.
Standing up, posturing up. We'll see if he can do something here. Both guys wearing matching sprawl shorts. I wondered if they coordinated beforehand.
Sam Holloway on top, Will Moore on bottom, and now Sam's starting to put it together in the mount position.
I think Sam knows he's not really in any danger to lose this. He just, he needs to finish this. Moore's top hanging in there.
And Andy Foster's going to stop it there. His corner was calling for it halfway through the round, and he finally put it together and finished Will. A tough Will Moore. Will Moore showed a lot of heart tonight, but
Sam's, another great show of respect. These guys just went through it.
Yeah, these guys are consummate professionals.
Go over and shake each other's hand. That's what the sport's all about to me. Just building relationships like that. It's, we'd like to see. I'd love to see Sam out here in the kind of shape that he showed in for this fight. He had a game plan. He stuck to it, and he absolutely dominated Will Moore.
Yeah, he was definitely in 15-minute shape for this fight. He's probably in 20-minute, 25-minute shape, training at the hardcore gym. Says definitely no surprise he was in shape and brought it tonight and finished the fight. It's a good feeling to finish a fight instead of putting it in the judges' hands.
Definitely. And you can't ask for a better place to be than hardcore right now. I mean, that's so many tough guys coming out of there.
The 11th fight of the night, Andy Foster bringing both fighters to the center. Was scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. Mixed martial arts. In round three, at the 4-minute and 14-second mark, stoppage by the referee due to strikes. Your winner, blue corner, Sam Holloway. Sam Holloway, Marietta, Georgia, out of Hardcore Gym, is your winner, blue corner. Let's hear it for Will Moore, red corner. Nice fight. Again, stoppage by the referee in the third round. All right, while Tom's being checked out at this time, I'll introduce to you in the red corner, already in the ring. He is the Southeastern middleweight champion. He's 32 years of age, 5'10", 185 pounds, from Johnsonville, North Carolina. Fights for Team ROC with a record of 12-7. Again, the champion of the Southeastern middleweight, Romez Brower, red corner. His opponent, 31 years of age, 5'10", 185 pounds, out of Grantville, Georgia, fighting for X3 Sports, with a record of 6 wins, 1 loss, Tom Wynn, blue corner. Welcome to round one. Again, this is the co-main event scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. It's our 12th fight of the night. Main event coming your way. Let's hear it, Wild Bills. This is what you've been waiting on.
Wild Bills Fight Night 13, Full Throttle Entertainment, brought to you by Hooters, No Excuses Sports Nutrition. We got Tom Wynn, Romez Brower.
This was a war last time. I'm excited to see this. I'm Kyle Maynard, sitting here with Cliff Fretwell. This is going to be an exciting fight, ladies and gentlemen. This is
co-main event, Tom Wynn, red hair. Romez Brower, camouflage shorts.
Romez is the kind of guy that'll take any fight anywhere. The guy's fought Gideon Ray. He's fought Ed Herman, UFC veterans. Decent. He's got solid stand-up skills. Stood there and traded with Tom Wynn last time. Tom Wynn's pro boxer. I mean,
yeah,
the guy's...
Romeo's brought... He's been in there with some tough guys. Fought Crafton Wallace. He beat David Hewitt, who's no slouch himself. Real tough guy. This guy's fought some who's who of MMA.
He actually... Romez is... He's controlling the clinch right here, but his day job is he's a barber. He cuts hair outside of Fort Bragg, works about 12-hour days, and then trains at night. The guy is just he's got terrific athleticism. He's he's willing to take the fight anywhere, wherever it goes, whether it's standing up or on the ground in the clinch.
Tom Wynn's definitely been training a lot for this. I was talking to his trainer Kevin Gittemeyer, and they trained specific things that Tom. You know, they felt like Tom needed to work on that he didn't do in the first fight. And Tom's got a good wrestling background. Me and him actually wrestled at the same time in high school, different teams. So he's definitely got a good bit of wrestling background. So he's working in the clinch here, but he's not being as active as I'd like him to be in the clinch, working for a takedown or working to get cut loose like his corner's asking him to.
I think, it's going to be like we had discussed previously, just cutting down on some of these, just useless scrambles where he was just overpowered by Romez in the last fight. Right. Last fight went to the judges. It was, I believe, a unanimous decision in favor of Romez, but it was 29-28. Tom handily won the second round with some stand-up, solid striking, and Romez was just able to secure a takedown and work from Tom's guard, and didn't really land too many dangerous shots or getting too many dangerous submissions, but they kept a solid pace the whole time.
Tom really needs to pummel out of this clinch. He needs to pummel out of the clinch instead of clamping down on the body. He needs to get his right arm in and get it up under and underhook Romez's left arm and just pummel out. Romez is just smothering him here, taking pot shots with the knees. They're not really doing any damage, but in the judge's eyes, Romez is trying to inflict damage, and he's controlling where Tom is.
Exactly.
He's not going to hit that inside trip on Romez.
I think that Romez is doing a good job of keeping his hips back from that, that inside trip. Romez is just a powerful guy. If you look at the size of his back here and how wide he is, I mean, he's really, he's going to fight hard. He doesn't want to be on his back. I've seen quite a few of his fights, and, I don't know if I've ever seen him in his guard before.
Yeah, Tom needs a pummel out of here. He's trying to force the outside and the inside trip. He needs a circle with his left underhook and get off the ropes. There you go.
This is where Tom's going to have that advantage.
Tom just needs to box him here. He's in great shape. Kevin Gittermeyer's training for this fight. They've been training for 2-3 months. Oh, Romez Brower catching him with a right hook there, it looked like. Tom's still trying to force this inside trip. Like we said, Tom Wynn's an accomplished pro boxer, 5-1. Before he fought Romez, he was coming off a big win over Todd Carney that nobody thought he would win. And he finished the fight pretty impressively over Todd Carney.
He should be able to do something here on against the ropes. He's got the double underhooks.
He's going to wear himself out here. Romez is clamped down with double overhooks. Unless he steps in deep and gets a low body lock and get his hips close to Romez's hips, he's just going to waste a bunch of energy here bullying Romez around the ring. Andy Foster might eventually step in and get these guys to break up because they're really not doing much here.
Yeah, almost exclusively work from the clinch.
Yeah, Tom could throw right elbows over the top here if he wanted to.
I believe that's what the instruction, Kevin Gettemeyer's instructors in his corners telling him to do here is he needs to show those short shots, you know, and work inside the clinch
there. That was a nice elbow. Tom had a nice elbow then, but he needs to get his hips in. Now, notice how Romez immediately gets his hips away with the overhooks. He just needs to box him here. Just throw that jab out there, measure him, and then try to get your shots off.
His corner's just telling him, yeah, yelling at him to box. It's where he needs to be. He needs to keep this edge.
He needs to steal this round right here. Tom can steal this round.
I think he may have with a couple of those flurries there.
Looks like Romez was rocked a little bit there at the end of the round. That's going to be the end of round one. I think it was more of a glancing blow.
Romez is a tough guy to finish. I mean, you know, like I said, he's not really exclusive with anybody. You're training full time. He's got to devote himself to having a real life, a real job. And Tom's the same way. He runs a software development company.
Yeah. But both of these guys, I think, honestly, that the first round looked like they both came out and gave each other a little too much respect. It was like the rematch. One was trying to see what the other one's game plan was going to be, and it was kind of an uneventful first round. Romez caught Tom with a shot early and maybe a couple of shots later on. Tom caught him with a glancing shot late in the fight. Pretty even fight, but judges are probably going to give it to Romez, A, because he controlled the clinch a little bit more and kept Tom pinned up against the ropes. That's not necessarily finishing the fight or causing damage, but you either score it even or you got to pick a guy.
Yeah, it could be. It could go either way. That last flurry there by Tom could send the round his way.
Could have stalled the round. That's the last thing the judges saw was Tom being active. So it looks like he got some well-needed instruction from his corner. He's going to come out and try to push the pace here.
There it goes. I think he needs to stay out of that body lock.
Yeah, he needs to stay out of this
clinch.
He's
the one that's jumping in and forcing that. You know, it'd be a lot better, in my opinion. You know, it's hard to be an armchair quarterback in this situation, but, you know, I think he needs to stay back and just stand there and box him. You know, who knows? Maybe he's felt Romez's power and doesn't want to be in that spot.
If Tom's going to stay here, I would honestly, and I know Kevin, the guy that trains him, Kevin Gettemeyer, is actually trained the strategy, is kneeing the guy's legs, taking his legs away from him, and really working on his legs. But you got to have Brower in the position that Tom's in right now. And Brower's controlling the fight again. And although uneventful, he's still controlling the fight. Tom spun him off the ropes here, but Tom's got to be active now.
You know, a good spot here would be, it'd be perfect time for Tom to push off the hips, create some space, and then...
And I think Romez needs to be more active here, too. I mean, we're talking a lot about what Tom needs to do, but, I mean, if Romez is going to push the pace and try to finish Tom, then he needs to get out of this clinch situation, too. He's not going to finish him with a knee to the body. You know, he's not going to finish him in a clinch situation. They both need to get out of this clinch if they plan on finishing the fight.
You know, that's one thing that a lot of people don't understand is that, you know, there's clinch fighting here. There's three ranges of fighting, and this is one of the, you know, a major range here. Yeah. You got the stand-up range, and then you got the clinch, and then the ground game. And this work from the clinch is a whole art in itself.
But nobody's really being active from the clinch. That's what both corners are screaming and yelling about. Tom's starting to be a little bit more active, but Romez is just kind of content to overhook, underhook, push him into the corner, and neither guys are really being active here.
Yeah, you know, I think the thing that you're right goes back to the respect thing, you know, partially. I've had the experience before, you know, when you train with somebody all the time and you step in there against them in competition, right. You know what they're capable of. Yeah, you know, you probably know what they're going to be going for. And, you know, you almost just, you're too hesitant to pull the trigger on something. When you don't know the person, you can go out there and, you know, take some chances and then I think they're giving too much respect to one another.
Yeah, Tom needs to pummel out and be active. So does Romez. Romez doesn't need to stay in this clinch either. He might be winning the round, but he's not going to finish the round. And in a fight like this where both guys really aren't doing much, you don't want to leave that in the judges. You definitely don't want to leave that in the judges' hands. Andy Foster. Honestly, if I was in Andy Foster's shoes, I might have even broken him up by now and started him back center and told him to be active. I mean, at the end of the day, these guys are here to entertain the crowd as well as fight. And right now, they're kind of just hanging in this clinch here.
Yeah, I agree. You know, it's a tough, tiring spot to be in. That's kind of one thing that people don't understand.
And there goes Tom. Romez looking to counterpunch here. Tom's unloading here. Wild Bill's Fight Night 13. We got Tom Wynn, Romez Brower.
Bro, Tom landed.
Tom got a shot, and then Romez
right
landed
hand.
One right back. Nice flurry there.
I think that's one reason why. I mean, we just saw why these guys are both content with staying in the clinch. Both of them have knockout power.
Tom's starting to figure this out and get his distance and get out of the clinch, but it was kind of even in the last exchange. Romez was counterpunching, but he landed a solid shot too. Nice flurry.
Romez
Tom's
is ducking
catching
his
him
head.
With some shots.
Tom's able to avoid those looping punches Romez is coming back with and firing.
Romez is definitely in counterpunch mode, but he's landing a couple. Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, Cliff Fretwell, Kyle Maynard here with you. Wild Bill's Country Club. Brought to you by Full Throttle Entertainment. We got 185-pound pro rematch. Romez Brower, Tom Wynn. Tom Wynn, red hair. Romez Brower, camouflage shorts. Tom loading up heavy with that left, straight left hand. Now the crowd's starting to get into a lot of clinching earlier, a lot of chess matching earlier, if you will. And
Tom's finally able to work that southpaw a little bit and go in there and land those left shots. That left hand needs to start letting loose. Romez is keeping his hands a little bit lower.
He's looking to counterpunch and clinch here, and Tom's looking to stay active. I think Tom's definitely controlled this round and probably won this round, but he can't let up and relax. As we saw in the first round, Tom could have stole the round from Romez, as Romez could steal the round now. Short time.
Oh, Romez is landing
here.
Some shots.
Yeah,
Romez
landed
one and
two
there.
Tough shots there at the end. I think it's one apiece going into the third round.
I think so, too. And, you know, this is almost the exact same situation that we were in last time. You know, in the last fight, Tom was able to win the second round. Romez had taken the first. And in that third round, Romez just kept going after him, wearing him down, and finally got the judge's decision.
And if you also notice, just to point out a subtle detail, boxing, the guys always sit down in between rounds because they're long rounds. They're shorter. It's a longer duration of the fight. They're shorter rounds, but you fight for a longer period of time. MMA, longer rounds, shorter period of time. You'll notice Tom Wynn standing up and Romez Brower sitting down. A lot of guys prefer to stand up because when you sit down and then when you stand back up, your heart has to catch back up to pump the blood to the rest of your body because you were sitting down, and it can cause you to fatigue a little bit quicker. So just a subtlety there about different things. You'll see a lot of Muay Thai fighters and kickboxers stand up in between rounds. A, because their legs are taking damage, but B, when your heart speeds back up, when you stand back up, sometimes that can play a role in how you fatigue in the round.
That's an interesting way to put it. I never thought about that. I won't be bringing a stool to a fight anytime soon after hearing that.
I won't charge you for that tip. Wild Bill's Fight Night 13, third round. Tom Wynn, Romez Brower. I'm Cliff Fretwell here with Kyle Maynard, Full Throttle Entertainment. And look, in our opinion, it's one apiece. Romez Brower controlled the first round, kind of uneventful. Second round started out uneventful, but Tom Wynn started breaking the clinch and pushing the boxing pace. And it looks like this round's going to decide the fight of the rematch.
Tom's able to go back and do the same thing. He's trying to work the hand control right here and pummel off. He needs to use that underhook and escape.
He's looking for the takedown there instead of the break. Inside trip might be there, but Romez is clamped down heavy with those overhooks. It's really hard to trip a guy when he's got those overhooks like that and his hips away. Like I said, we had talked about Tom was a high school wrestler. It's obvious that Romez has trained some grappling, if not wrestled himself. It's going to be hard to take a guy down, but look how active Tom is. Romez Brower
catches him. Tom's finally throwing some heavy shots in that clinch
there.
Yeah, but
Romez caught him back with a counterpunch, but I'll tell you, Tom Wynn's got a beard on him, and Romez does too because he's taken quite a few shots in this fight as well.
Still working from the clinch. Romez hasn't really done anything to try to take him down. You see Tom working those inside trips. Romez is controlling him and controlled the ring, but you know, ring control, is that much of a factor as, you know, trying to pummel away, trying to work for the boxing? I mean,
right.
It's hard to say. It's hard for the judges.
185-pound pros. Romance Brower, camouflage shorts fighting out of Team Rock, North Carolina. Tom Wynn, Grantville, Georgia, fighting out of X3 gym in Marietta.
X3 Tom, there, training with Kevin Gittemeyer, Tony Tucci. You got some great guys down there. They're
James
setting up a
Black
really
Lake
great program.
Thorbs out there.
Exactly.
They got a decent stable of fighters, and as Romez does, training with Team Rock up in North Carolina. If either of these guys are wanting to finish the fight, they've got to break this clinch. They're not going to finish the fight in the clinch, throwing body knees. I really look for Tom to just throw that left underhook to the ceiling and just spin out of this clinch here.
If he went and spun to his right, use that underhook.
Oh! Tom Wynn finally gets the takedown he was looking for. He had been working the whole fight, probably about 12 minutes of this fight to get the takedown. He finally got it, and let's see what he does on top against Romez Brower.
Just as we said before, you know, we were talking about him working for that inside trip. Looked like he got a little bit of a foot sweep there on that one, kind of a prop.
It was more of a knee block slash foot sweep than it was a trip. But look for Tom to be busy here, and look for Romez to try to clamp down and hopefully get a stand up.
This is a position I've never seen Romez fight from before.
Yeah, you had mentioned that earlier in the fight.
This is going to be interesting to see how he's able to react from this. Tom, you know, was working from an open guard for a while. Romez has got it closed now.
He's
pretty burst in jiu-jitsu. It's hard to tell so far. Tom hasn't really done
Tom's
much to pass.
Tom's looking for a pass here. Andy Foster, our referee, having to jump up on the ropes, a little high-flying acrobat on the ropes there. Guards open. Tom in looking to pass. He's firing hammer fists down the middle. They kind of been blocked by Romez. Romez counters. Look like for a second Tom might be thinking about falling back for a heel hook, but he might just be trying to stuff that foot through.
Yeah, I think Tom's trying to posture up. I mean, he needs to do something with this open guard here. Either Romez is baiting him to try to come into a half guard position, or he's just leaving it open there out of fatigue.
Tom's corner's yelling 1 minute. They want him to finish strong. He needs to posture up and look to throw some blows here. He's trying to stuff those legs by.
If he can stuff that knee and come through and pass here.
Tom's looking to stuff the knee. Oh, he's got side control. Nice pass by Tom. He's going to look to.
The mount is open. The mount's wide open.
I don't think Tom wants to take mount. He trains a ton of side control. Romez has got him locked down. Tom needs a circling to the middle of the ring, sit through with his left hip, and then he can rain elbows down, and that way Romez can't chase his bottom leg and hook him. But Tom really needs to throw some bows here and finish the round strong, put an exclamation point on the fight, and hopefully win the fight.
You know, Romez, it looked like he had, really there with that open guard. I wasn't really sure if that had just been a jiu-jitsu inexperience. If, you know, that closed guard, no matter what. Whether you're a white belt or a black belt, it's much harder to pass that guard when somebody's closing their guard.
Short time here in the fight. I got to give it to Romez. Even though Tom passed and got side control, he did a good job of clamping him down and actually got a sweep there, just powered out a sweep.
It'll be interesting to see this. We've got another one going to the judges again.
Romez slaps the apron of the ring like he knows he lost the fight.
On my card, I'd have to give it to... have to give it to Tom, 2 rounds to 1.
Not a very action-packed fight. Not a lot of submission attempts. Actually, not a ton of flurries, but it had a pretty climactic ending there with a little scramble, couple sweeps. Tom got a guard pass.
We're here with UFC veteran Rory Singer.
Rory, would you like to comment on the fights this far this evening?
Fights so far have been fantastic. This fight here with Tom and whoever this guy is.
I don't even know anybody's name.
Romez Brower.
Romez Brower.
Romez Brower from Team Rock.
Was action-packed and and fantastic, but I gotta give the edge to Tom. I saw about 2.5 rounds, and I think Tom won at least 2 rounds, so unanimous 29-28 if I were the judge.
I'd have to see it along the same way.
I think I gotta agree with Rory Singer, even though that's probably the first time I've...
Of course you have to agree with me.
I've never agreed with him before in my entire life. This is the first time. Tom is walking.
No, I am Rory Singer.
we did not rent a Rory Singer Enterprise look-alike tonight. This is really Rory Singer. Rory Singer in person actually cost the same as the guy that looks like Rory Singer to come.
At this time, Andy Foster will bring both the fighters from the co-main event into the center ring. Again, it was scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. It went the distance. Both of these fighters have a lot of mutual respect for each other. Judge A saw 28-29. Judge B, 27-30. C, 28-29. Unanimous decision. The win goes to blue corner, Tom Nguyen. Tom Nguyen, Grantville, Georgia, X3 Sports. Blue corner takes the win, now with a record of 7-1. Let's hear it for his opponent, Romance Brower, red corner. Give him a round of applause. Great fight. All the fighters are in a hurry. We appreciate it. Introducing to you right now, main event. Give these guys a round of applause. Red corner, 22 years of age, 5'10", 165 pounds from Long Island, New York. Fighting for Team Emerson Sosa with a record of 8-6. Red corner, Andrew Montanez. His opponent in the blue corner, 19 years of age, 6', 165 pounds from East Bridgewater, Maine. Fighting for Team Aggression, Dan Lozon, blue corner. You've seen it, round one. Welcome to the main event. Again, we're in hurry up offense. Wild Bills, this is it. Let me hear you scream. These guys are ready to fight. Come on.
Pro MMA, Full Throttle Fight, Full Throttle Entertainment, Wild Bills Fight Night 13. I'm Cliff Fretwell here along with Kyle Maynard, sponsored by Hooters, No Excuses Sports Nutrition. You can check all their stuff out at noexcusesathletics.com.
This fight started with a big flurry and a combo, and Montanez is in trouble here. Montanez has actually won the last like 4 or 5 pro fights he's had. I mean, the guy has been on a tear, trains with Emerson Sousa, but Dan Lozon is UFC veteran, tough kid, 19 years old.
Team Aggression, 19 years old. Kid brother to UFC veteran Joe Lozon. Dan's one appearance in the UFC was against Spencer Fisher on short notice. If anybody's, if you're no stranger to MMA, you know any fight against Spencer Fisher is going to be tough, let alone short notice. Montanez actually... I was about to say Montanez was doing an okay job of scooting back out of that.
He was doing a good job of defending that. I think that might have been a little bit of an early stoppage. So I think he feels the same way.
Either way, good win for Dan Lozon.
Big celebration there by Dan Lozon.
Those crazy nights, I do remember in my youth. I do recall those were the best times, most of all.
All right, Andy Foster calls our fighters into the center ring. Again, main event. Special thanks again to the Georgia Athletic Entertainment Commission. This fight was scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. First round at the 1 minute and 48 second mark. Your winner, blue corner, Dan Lauzon. Dan Lauzon, your winner from Team Aggression, East Bridgewater, Maine. Let's give him a round of applause now with a record of 8-2.